Hi everyone, this is Lénorde and today we are talking about filter tuning in Betaflight. This video is the first of the series, so we will keep it simple for now, but we will also discover the use of Blackbox Explorer to tune our quad right after the logo. First of all, what are filters and why do we need to tune them? Well, your gyroscope is actually sending a noisy signal to your flight controller, which looks like this, and filters will make it look like this. Without filters, your motors would try to react to these fast oscillations, so they would heat and eventually burn. So filters are basically there to protect your motors, that's why we need them. But most of the time, Betaflight's default settings apply much more filter than we actually need. Why is that a problem? Well, in order to clean the signal, filters have to collect the data first and then process it. By the time your flight controller receives the filtered signal, some time has gone. This is called the phase delay. The phase delay is only a few milliseconds, so that's not something you will notice as a pilot. But when your quad has to react very quickly, this small delay can cause troubles to adapt fast enough to the oscillations. That's exactly what's happening with prop wash. Your quad tries to compensate, but it's always a bit late, so it keeps oscillating again and again and again. Reducing the amount of filters also reduces the phase delay, so that means better overall performance. But we also need to keep enough filtering to prevent our motors from overheating. Filter tune will be about finding the right balance. I will be working on Betaflight 4.2 and I also advise you to upgrade to the latest version if you want to get the best performance. Here is the filter settings tab in Betaflight. Don't worry, it's much simpler than it looks. This section is all about the gyro filters and we will control them with this slider. And this one is about D-term filtering, which will be controlled with this slider. Yes, we also need to clean the D-term signal the same way we do with the gyro, but we will cover that later. And for the rest of the page, well, that's what we need to set right now. The gyro RPM filters were introduced in Betaflight 4.0 and they are very efficient, so naturally we want to make sure it is activated. In order to get the RPM filters, you first need to go to the configuration tab and make sure that bidirectional D-shot is enabled. You don't need to change the default settings of the RPM filter, but the dynamic filter is not set to the optimal value. These settings are trying to track the motor noise, but it's already been cleaned by the RPM filter. So we will adjust the value to track anything else we would like to filter, like a frame resonance or bent propeller or anything else. The recommended settings are 0%, a notch Q of 250, and the frequency will go from 90 Hz to 350 Hz. Pushing these sliders to the right will increase the filter frequency. I don't want to get too mathematical with that, but that's what we call reducing filters. It will lead to less filtering and it will reduce the phase delay. As you can see, at some point, Betaflight gives you a warning message. That's because reducing the filters too much can be dangerous for your quad, as I explained earlier. And if you want to go above 1.5 on these sliders, you first need to enable expert mode right there. To get the right tune, we want to increase these sliders together a few notches at a time, and then make sure our quad can handle it. That's where Blackbox Explorer will come in very handy. But for the first test flight, we want to leave them at default for now. So the very last thing we want to set is the Blackbox. You need to go to the Blackbox tab, enable the recording, set the logging rate at 2 kHz, and finally set the debug mode to gyro scaled. This will record the gyro data before the filtering, so we can compare it with the filtered signal. Just hit save and you're good to go. To get a good log file, here is what you will try to do. You can fly FPV or line of sight if you can, preferably in acro mode. You need to use the whole range of your throttle, so go for some throttle punches a few times. You need data across all three axes, even though yaw is not the most important right now, so do some flips and rolls. And the last thing you want to do is to get some prop wash. Try to fly like this for about 2 minutes at least. When you land, check the temperature of your motors by pinching them. If they are slightly warm, that's definitely okay. But if they are so hot that they hurt, you may need to apply more filtering rather than reducing them. If that's the case for you, the Blackbox Explorer may give you some hints on what's wrong. After that first test flight, let's open our file and see what our black box looks like. If you use your flight controller flash memory, you need to go to Betaflight and get to the Blackbox tab. There, you can activate Mass Storage Device, which will let your flight controller become a classic storage device. You can now easily access the flash memory of your flight controller and copy your log from there. Then, you need to download the Blackbox Explorer from the link in the description below and install it. You can now easily open your file. In the Blackbox Explorer, we can see almost all the data from a specific flight. But I will only talk about the tools for analyzing the quad noise and tuning the filters. We will hit the graph setup and remove all the graphs. You can now add the graph gyro, debug, and also a custom graph. For this custom graph, I will select the PID D and save changes. You can also isolate a specific part of the flight. I like to remove the takeoff and the landing, which can cause weird oscillations and could pollute our data. So in this timeline down here, it displays your throttle value over the flight. I will click a bit after the beginning of the flight and hit I on my keyboard for the in point, and then click near the end and hit O for the out point. If you click on any of those buttons, it will show the graph analyzer from any of those data. Let's see the gyro scale first, so we can have a look at all the noise from our quad before the filtering. On the horizontal axis, you can see all the different frequencies, and the vertical axis is the amplitude or the amount of those frequencies. The left part of this graph is the actual quad movements, so this is your stick movements. That's why there is so much of it, so you don't have to worry. Anything above that will represent the oscillations we want to deal with. If you have a spike around 70 or 100 Hz, it will most probably be the prop wash. And the white noise you can see here is the motor noise. There will always be that kind of noise on every quad, but depending on your motors, your quad size or weight, this will look different and can be at higher or lower frequencies. The reason why it is so wide is because the motor noise frequency rises with your throttle. So that's why we want to use the whole range of our throttle, so we can see how wide the motor noise actually is. Now that you have an idea on how to interpret this data, let's check what the filtered signal looks like by clicking on the gyro graph analyzer. As you can see, the filters did a great job here. There is no noise at all on any axis. But if we compare the gyro roll, for example, with the PID-D roll, you can see that it got amplified a little bit. This is because of the nature of the D-term, which is extremely sensitive. Even the slightest noise can be amplified and will be sent to the motor as a noisy signal. But in this case, it is still being filtered quite well, and I am not worried about this amplitude at all. That means we have some room to reduce our filtering by moving the sliders to the right. You can increase them by 2 notches at a time, so I will leave them at 1.2 and do another test flight. Here is what my test flight with the sliders at 1.2 looks like. Since there is not much difference, I will keep going. You can keep pushing your sliders to the right 1 or 2 notches at a time, depending on the amount of noise that is ending up in your gyro signal, on your D-term, or also if your motors are getting hot. If you think you reached a point where you went a bit too aggressive with your tune, you can always go back by lowering the sliders by 1 notch, and then make a comparison with a new test flight. Let's fast forward to the end result. In my case, I left the slider at 1.5, and there are a few reasons why I didn't want to go higher. The reason why I stopped at 1.5 is because some motors were getting a bit hotter than before, and I want to keep them safe. The second reason is because if you are too aggressive with your filters, and you happen to have some bent propeller, or if you damage your propeller after a crash, the noise from your damaged propeller could burn your motors too. So I want to be able to get my quad back safely, even if there is a damaged propeller. And finally, I feel like my quad is flying very well. I cannot see any prop wash at all right now. So there is no reason to push my sliders even further if I cannot get any more performance while risking my quad components. Of course, I'm tuning a freestyle quad here that is carrying a GoPro. If you are tuning a racing quad, you may want to go a bit more aggressive and get all the performance available from your quad. So it is technically possible to go to the end of the slider range and get good results, but you have to be very careful if you are doing this. So that's it for the easy method. You should now have an increased performance while still making sure your motors are safe. If you want to push your tune even further, the next video of the series will cover more advanced tools like PID Toolbox. So make sure to subscribe to the channel if you don't want to miss the rest of the series. And as always, hit the thumbs up to let me know if this video was helpful for you. Thanks everyone for watching, and I'll see you next time.